Thank you for coming through, Andre. So we continue talking about this difficult operating environment in South Africa. From a packaging perspective, what are your issues that you have had to deal with in this set of numbers?
You know, the challenge that I think the entire consumer-facing value chain in South Africa has got is that given the pressure that the consumer is under, higher fuel prices, higher electricity prices, a VAT increase, lower disposable income is translating into less discretionary spending in retail stores. That translates into pricing pressure on our customers, the major food and beverage companies, which in turn translates into pressure on volumes and margins for a company like Nampak.
So volumes for you in this set of numbers were under pressure. They were
correct.
Down.
Yes, they were down.
And when you look at across the products that you package, where would you say the greatest amount of pressure is coming through?
You know, what I find very interesting is that we can see consumers trading down. So instead of buying meat or fish in a can, they start to buy baked beans as a substitute source of protein, which is a clear indication of the pressure that the consumer is facing.
I think you've been looking into my house budget.
And the same on branded products, for example, personal care products. People are going for value brands as opposed to the premium brands.
Yeah.
And that is a trend that clearly indicates that there is pressure and that people are postponing purchases even of the most basic necessities, which is a source of concern.
Absolutely. So this is South Africa, but you also have challenges elsewhere on the continent, Angola in particular. I mean, we've talked about the story of Angola and the kind of challenges that that economy is facing. What's your sense in terms of the issues that you had to deal with in this set of numbers and trying to just take a look going forward? Yeah.
You know, the way to think about an economy that has gone through a major currency devaluation is the dynamic that we've seen repeat itself in Egypt, the same dynamic that has played out in Nigeria.
Yeah.
So initially, raw materials go up because of the devaluation in the currency. That means producer price inflation goes up, consumer price inflation goes up, and then there's a period of adjustment where disposable income is significantly eroded before wage inflation catches up. And once wage inflation is caught up, then consumers start to buy products again.
Yeah.
And we are now in the middle of that low point of disposable income in Angola. So we expect that the situation will normalize in the next 18 to 24 months.
Right. That's Angola.
That's Angola.
But there's also Zimbabwe next door. There's also Nigeria.
Yes.
Though Nigeria, surprisingly, I saw is a bright spot for you.
Correct. We are very bullish about Nigeria. We think with 180 million potential consumers in Nigeria, the economy is recovered, the currency has adjusted to a new level, there is macroeconomic and policy certainty. So our volumes were up 17%, which is fantastic. And we are now contemplating further
investment. This is not a low base, right?
No, this is off a high base. Yeah. We've just announced that we're going to be investing 100 million rand in a new food can line in Nigeria. So the opportunities are absolutely there, and we believe that we know how to operate in that country. Some mention has been made of political risk.
Yes.
In Nigeria, we're not concerned about that. We fly under the radar. We don't offend anybody. We keep a low profile.
Yeah.
And therefore, we think it's a good place for us to do business.
I was going to say ask MTN, and also the decision to establish an international board to advise the company. You're not going down that route, are you?
It's not necessary for us. No,
you don't need to do that.
We're small compared to MTN.
Zimbabwe.
Zimbabwe is very difficult to read at this point in time.
Yeah.
Following the introduction of the RTGS dollar as the formal official currency as opposed to the US dollar, there has been a devaluation in the currency. The black market rate is significantly below the official rate. We have taken a very conservative approach to our cash that we've got in Zimbabwe. We've written it down from 723 to 466 million rand.
Sure.
We have, however, got a hedge in place with a sovereign entity in Zimbabwe, which protects us on a one-to-one basis for the cash that we've got.
Yeah.
But as I've said, we've taken the conservative view, so there could be upside to our cash in Zimbabwe.
Don't get me wrong on my next question on Zimbabwe, but I'm just wondering what's keeping you there given the kind of challenges that that economy is facing on the political front as well as on the economic front.
Volumes remain remarkably strong. This is an economy that has been extremely resilient. The Zimbabwe consumer is inventive and innovative, and we still are able to use our facilities there, which are very, very well run and are competitive to export to other countries. And then, of course, we also supply packaging for the tobacco industry.
Right.
And that is a major forex earner for Zimbabwe, which earns us forex to buy raw materials with. So we are able to keep on operating in that country.
Here in South Africa, looking again forward to the future, we had a cabinet that came through yesterday from President Cyril Ramaphosa. I want your thoughts on that. Then I also want your thoughts on the competitor that you talk about in this set of numbers, two new competitors that you said come into the South African market. How big and significant are they, and what's the risk to margins?
Let me first talk about the cabinet. I think it's fantastic that we have responsible, experienced ministers in charge of the key economic portfolios in cabinet. Minister Tito Mboweni, we know him well. He used to be our chairman.
Sure.
So we.
I forgot.
So we're very excited that he's elected to stay on in cabinet. The amalgamation of economic development and trade and industry is a move that's long overdue. Yeah. Minister Patel is a very hard-working, very intelligent minister, so we expect very good things from him. He's very open to engagements. So we think that these moves are positive, and we look forward to policy changes that will really encourage investment. Moving on to the competitor that we have engaged in the market, a new line has been installed. We've been able to, through cost-cutting measures, we've been able to protect both margins as well as our trading profit, so we have been able to meet the competitor in the market, and by prudent management and efficiencies, we are meeting the challenge.
Lastly, so you say Africa is a difficult place, and yet the IMF is saying five of the 10 fastest growing economies in the world, guess what, are African.
Yes.
How come you're not finding them?
We are in those markets. We definitely all the way in Nigeria, and that's why we're so excited about
Ghana.
Nigeria. Ghana, we are exploring export opportunities to Ghana. It is as yet a market that's too small for us to establish a manufacturing presence there, but clearly on the radar screen as a market that we would like to enter.
And very quickly, how important is Africa now in terms of revenue contribution?
Revenue is quite low. It's actually about 35%. Profit, though, it's about 63%.
Oh, where do you want to take revenue?
I'd like to get to 50% revenue from the rest of Africa, which will mean that profit contribution will be about 65-70%.
Absolutely. Andrew Dureta, thank you for coming through.
Thank you very much.
He's the CEO of NAMPAC.